two more elementary filters to go. The first order infinite impulse response filter characterized this transfer function, one pole from zero, it's set to zero. And then the second one, this second degree polynomial here, the second order infinite impulse response filter with two feedback paths. You will see the block semantic. And focus on how to solve this equation. Now, the easiest way is to just factorize it beforehand and write the solutions as P1 and P2. Just do it like that and then you try to compute P1 and P2 because then you have the two poles. First do the order one filter. Order one pole. I have here two examples. This is in fact this is infinite impulse response with alpha smaller than one, and this is an infinite impulse response with alpha larger than one, and this goes to infinity, so this explodes. And that's what you see here, the pole is here. If you should move the pole of backwards, then this should go down, it should go to convergence again. Here are some other, these are examples from second order. Second order responses. Is, you have two poles here, or two poles here. We'll come to that. This is pole zero, this better picture. So this. First the order one infinite impulse response filter. One pole, one zero. Okay. Now the restriction for the alpha is obligatory, minus 1 to plus 1, it can also be negative, and we shall see what the negative alpha will be. This is, just for example, if you take, if alpha is real, then okay, here you have a real pole, if alpha should be complex, it should be here, and then you should have a type of single sideband filter. But, yeah, then you should take other measures to achieve this. It's the same as in analog modulation, single sideband modulation. You work with analytical signals with complex harmonics. Normally you use this. The pole is on the real axis. Now the is positive. Sometimes it can be negative. Yeah, okay, what I do here, if you want to find the pole for a complex value of alpha, now you just substitute it here and you write the sequence again, that is the most easiest part. You can, and then you do not have to deal with the fraction again, and you split it in a the real part and g times an imaginary part. This is what I already said. This will transform. I keep to you as a secret for the very last. If it is, if there's time left, I think so. Okay, this is a summary. This cube. This terms, this is from telecommunication. This is called in-phase and this is quadrature. Mm-hmm. Quadrature means perpendicular. This because it is all sine. Mm-hmm. Sine and cosine differ 90 degrees. This is, engineering glossary. Dus. Ja. Ja, dat is. Dus de summary is alpha's real. Ik heb even positive alpha. You have this monotonously decreasing impulse response. If it is negative, but within the unit circle, then you have a. It is also a real impulse response, but it is alternating plus minus plus minus plus minus plus minus. Yeah, it is as if there is a some. If you have sampled some harmonic, like a cosine. And for this, yeah, okay, this, I put for completeness, I do not use that. Except for the last one. Yeah, I have two types, and this is, of course, if you add up plus the exponent plus g and the exponent minus g, then you have cosine again, then the scale again. Yeah, okay, now again, these are the pictures. And this one is stable, and here the poles outside the unit circle is unstable. This one explodes, this diverges, this one converges. This is the equations explicitly. The transfer function, transfer function, or the pole zero diagram, as you do it here, there is you cut it open here and you roll it out, then here at 0 hertz you sense the influence of the pole, so here's a maximum. And the further you move away, so here is a minimum. So you have this type of characteristic. You can exactly compute it. I think this is the next slide. And this pole is here, because this belongs to this monotonously decreasing impulse response. If the alpha is here, you can get from this. If you, the alpha is negative, you see this negative, this is negative, negative squared, positive, negative, positive, and so on. So this is alternating, so you get something similar, but then plus, minus, plus, minus, plus. So a geometric sequence with an alternating sign. So it's almost negative. And then, again, if the then here you have a maximum, and here minimum, because here the pole is is nearby, and here the pole is remote. So this is a high pass filter, a very bad one, but it's a high pass behavior. Calculating the frequency response, so I did it now graphically. Now, you substitute this in the phase of Z, and you get this expression, and then. You can. You solve this, you write this as an expression of F. It is just. Computation is not a nice job. It can be done. A more nice way is a graphical way. If you realize that, let's go back to the slide. These type of equations with a linear or a first degree polynomial here and a first degree polynomial there. It's called a bilinear function. I think I mentioned this term before. A bilinear function, linear in the numerator, linear in the denominator. And one of the properties of a bilinear function, and this is from complex function theory, if in the Z you move around the circle, then the function of Z, H of Z, is also moving around the circle. Now, this is a gigantic help for constructing the values of HF. If you have only to find 3 points here, and you find 3 points here, and you are able to construct a circle. So then your whole all points of H of Z, complex plane, are defined. And and if you now, because here you have the frequencies, you have the frequencies here. If you now, walk, take with the same angle, yeah, here you go this way, and here you also go this way. I start here negative for some concrete reason. If you walk at a similar angle, you do the same here, and you see how this varies along the circle. And here you have a minimum, and here you have a maximum. Now, that's exactly what you see here. Here you have the minimum, and here you have the maximum. And here you, you can numerically compute by the easy values. For f is 0, f is the Nyquist frequency, f is halfway the Nyquist frequency, 3/4 of no, 1 divided by 40 is, 1 divided by 2 is, 3 divided by 40 is, 1 g minus 1 minus g. You can compute for these values this function. You have some easy points by which you easily can compute to see what the amplitude and argument is. So yeah, with this you can check what I've sketched here, is this correct? Here you see the values that come from this. The box magnetic we have seen it many times. There's nothing more to say about order one IR. This
AR structure?
Structure, yeah. Block schematic.
AR.
Ah, you weren't there yesterday. No. We have a glossary of terms for filters, and the one that is related to impulse response is finite impulse response, infinite impulse response. Autoregressive and moving average refers to the structure, the block schematic with feedforward and feedback paths, or to the transfer function with numerator and denominator. And most textbooks, that's how I separate them, make a mess of it, to say, I have a moving average filter and a fair filter, that say it is the same, make a complete mix up of terms. And you should really separate them. I explained here by this example. This is a finite impulse response filter. This is also a finite impulse response filter. This is a moving average structure. But this is an autoregressive structure. And this is also, this is a special case, this is a discount filter, also a moving average structure. Then it is correct, but if you mix up, if you misunderstand moving average with finite impulse response, then you mix up two worlds that refer to different domains. Impulse response and transfer function. And the other mix up, that is less, is a low pass, band pass, this refers to the frequency response. This is the autoregressive structure, this is feedback in the structure. Now the second order. How to solve it? What I said, I just rewrite it, and I look, I pretend that I already have found the solutions. The only thing, of course, I have to compute P1 and P2 as a function of 1, 2, 3 coefficients there. Okay, I don't bother. I just evaluate this formula and okay, I get at this solution, what you see here. If 1 coincides with A0, A1 coincides with minus this one, and A2 coincides with P1, P2. And that's okay, that's they are all real, of course. Yeah, that's a sign of presumption. But why should you make it complex? And the normal solutions that you find from your secondary school, I think you have same secondary school as I have. And this is the solution. You use this famous formula. You take plus or minus this one, then take square root of this squared again, and then the first and the third term minus 4 5 this. And you could, if eventually, you could also rewrite like this. And
then that was the Viet formula.
Yeah. and this far, it is all well known and familiar. And of course, this beneath the square root, yeah, this is of course the determinant, and the determinant, if it is negative, if this is positive, then I have real solutions, and it is negative, then I have to swap, then it becomes positive again, but then I get here a G in front, so I have complex number solutions. These on the real axis, these are in the complex plane. And you have a special case, when they are equal, then this is zero, this expression, and you left with this. And okay, what I presume P1 is smaller than P2. It means for the for the P1 I have here a minus sign, and for the P2 I have here a plus sign. Now, and this one is similar. Yeah, and this is the values of the discriminant. In fact, but in this way, it is already solved.
Can be more ambitious and remove the symmetry. And what you can do, remember from what? There is a formula somewhere in this book of Carmichael Schmidt, or other table books. You have a formula of cosine hyperbole and the normal cosine, which is related to the ellipse. And the formula of this is e to the power of theta plus e to the power of minus theta. And cosine, as we now know, is e to the power of plus g theta, e to the power of minus g theta. If you look closer, then this solution resembles this solution. Suppose I know that I can this one I can put here, but this one is less obvious. I can put here. If I put here, P1 is e to the plus theta, real number, just a real number. And e to the P2 is e to the power of minus theta. And then I look what. What I get is A2 is r squared. One is this. Then I could write a solution also in this way. And for the complex, this is for the two real poles. And it puts a relationship between the two real poles, how they are situated along some center. For theta 0, it should be around R, which is some Ja. Zo'n gravity center. Between them. En voor die stoel, ja, die is ook complex conjugates. Waar je om two sides of the real axis. De real axis serves as a center. Nou. Here you have the solutions in real numbers. Here you have them in complex conjugate r squared. And here minus 2r cosine theta. Now, and of course, if they coincide, you have here r squared. This one is r squared. And here theta is 1. So the cosine's maximum is 1. And here the cosine hyperbole theta with theta is minimum is also 1. So they coincide and you get this. Now, this is another way of solving the same equations, but now with different parameters. Now there's more symmetry also in the solution. Let's see how this works out. I substitute the solutions for real and for the positive the case of determinant, for the negative case of determinant, and for the when case the determinant is zero. Now, in the case of two real poles, I have to deal with this. This causes a discriminant. I'm making a mix up between algebra and. No, this is a discriminant, not a determinant. Here the discriminant is zero, and here the discriminant is smaller than zero. You can compute it and see all the previous slide back. To the postal, this complex consonant. One real pole, double. And now, look at the solutions. Now, you have two real poles. If you have the discriminant being positive, you have two real poles situated like this. And what is this point? This is R. And on both sides of R, and this distance is determined by this cosine hyperbole of theta. Theta, you can have the corresponding value. This is how they are related. So it's not that this one is arbitrary. No, if you place this one also has a place. In complex conjugate, it's easy. If this one is placed here, the other one is placed as well. No, but in this case, it's the same. They're not placed independently from one another. If you move this one here, this one will automatically move there. And this is what. be able to make a film out of it. I'm not a magician enough with computers. The trick is, if you move this one to this R, and this one moves, and for discriminant zero, they coincide. You have a double pole on this position. Of course, stable. Eh? This R is smaller than one. And if you now, then the discriminant is zero. If now the discriminant starts to become negative, then these poles, they start to move vertically. Like this. Here they move them and move like this. And I think one of the many exam questions is what. For several values of theta, describe the track of the poles when you turn on the key of the discriminant. This is typically a method from feedback control systems to tune up and play around with your poles. You see root locus designs. This is how second order the second degree, second order EIR filters work, second degree polynomials. The question is, does anyone have questions about how they coincide, how these two poles are related? Because that's crucial. That is, does not become zero visible from using A0, A1, A2. Becomes zero, it becomes clear from using cosine hyperbole and cosine. It's clear that these poles coincide, have a relationship, but these poles also have a relationship. Complex conjugate, these have a relationship by cosine hyperbole. That is. Okay, now, from the transfer function, we have the other one, that's the impulse response. And, no. okay, you can, like this equation, you can go put this back, and you see that you have the output times A0, and then normalize it. Is the input at a scaled one time delayed version of the output minus scaled two times delayed version of the output. This is the difference equation for which you have to solve, and this of course you what you see here is of course the solution for complex conjugate poles. And now you remember this table, lookup table method that I showed you. You look at the table and look how the complex poles, how they resemble. And you're able to substitute here the values, and you get for this, the cosine, you get something like this, and for the sine, always starts at zero, something like this. And the pole zero is the poles are similar, and for the cosine, there was an extra term one here. That's not it. You get an extra zero, which is absent here. The only thing you have to remember, actually, this is for complex conjugate poles, you have this type of response. And of course, they are convergent because you're stable. And this oscillating frequency, you can compute from this expression here, because this, this angle here is equal to this expression, you know, the sample, the sampling interval. So then you can compute the F0, the frequency at which it is oscillating. I put the numbers in here. So that's the way to compute all the parameters. Now something more. This is a very nice picture. Of course, I stole it from Richard Lyons. here you have this unit circle, and here you have this two complex conjugate poles. You have the real axis here, and here you see some chimneys. Here are the poles, and you see here how this frequency characteristic around the unit circle is formed by these two chimneys. And this is then what you see. And the more these poles are approaching the unit circle, yeah, the more steeper this becomes. And also the more discontinuous these phase shifts become. They seem linear. This is not a linear phase shift because it is because it is not an even or odd function for the impulse response. This is only a coincidence that it looks like this. The only demonstration is that for when the poles are approaching the unit circle, the amplitude goes up and the phase
makes more and more a big jump. It means that the more and more impossible it becomes to realize this filter. This is how the structure or the block diagram looks like. You have this end. I showed you how to construct this block diagram. You can take it from... I think the most easy in this way is to take it from the impulse response, the relationship. I showed it... this one, this equation, you have the output, the input, and the delayed versions of the output. These are the feedback paths. And then you get this schematic, and you can verify it if you take here the delayed version, the Z minus one. And then you end up with the transfer function. And of course, what I said, you can replace this by 2r cosine theta. This one is a2 by r squared. This is a minus sign. This is minus minus, so it becomes plus. And one of the questions, for completeness, I put here this transpose form that we discussed yesterday. This is similar, but I show you how to get into the transpose form. This is feedback, but here you do not have a delay line anymore. In feedback, you have delay element, addition, delay element, addition. That is then the structure. How to make this filter behave like an oscillator? Now, this R has to be 1, of course. And if this R is 1, then this becomes 2 times cosine theta. And look at the answer. This, and then you have to solve. Yes, you have the equation 2 pi f ts times f0, that's the theta, that's this one, and so you wanted that this frees you to oscillate, you put here the value that it oscillates, and you get here the corresponding angle in the complex plane, that's the explaining how to do it. So you have degrees of freedom to play around with this. And if this is 1, then you are on a unit circle. You can choose any oscillating frequency you like. Yeah, within the period of the observed, the period of frequency range, of course. Now the real solutions to real poles. Don't let be discouraged. I use this equation, and this is minus r squared. Yeah, this if you use this is almost identical. And what I can do with real poles, because they're real, I can write them in factors with real and I have the possibility to decompose, to write this as a series combination of two infinite impulse response filters of order 1. Because I can decompose it in two factors with real poles. So this is the correct solution, and the P1 and the P2 are related. They are related to A1 and A2 with this. So this is a valid solution. In the complex poles you do not have this, you cannot split them into infinite impulse response filters order 1. But the real poles, because you can write this as factor of two. Two factors containing the real poles. This is the discussion about second order infinite impulse response filters, how to analyze them. Higher order infinite impulse response filters you rarely find. Normally you split them into higher order filters in order 2 or order 1. So I did like, 2 times order 1. And normally you do not like to solve third degree equations or 4 degree equations. Has anyone done this, by the way? It's a nice mathematical exercise. Solving third order, third degree equations. It is historically, this is a very nice story. It was only in the 15th century that there was an Italian, Cardano, he was able to solve a third order equation, but in a very shaky way. He solved it, and I think he also stole some of the secrets from a mathematical competitor. But not quite clear, but it was solved in the 15th century by Cardano, and in the 17th century it was done by a French mathematician who worked it far better in a structured way. It's called Fieta. I think also from Italian descent, in the way to France. So it is only very lately solved. The Arabs didn't solve it. It's part of the Renaissance. That also a breakthrough in mathematics, that they were able to solve 4-degree equations. And in the end of the 18th century, then there's a Frenchman called Lagrange who solved it for all orders. And Lagrange is some kind of this few genius that existed. So, this is about the mathematics of how to solve nth degree equations. Here we stick to the order degree 1 or 2. All I can say about this, I skip this because I go quickly through them. Just for the engineers, this is important. If you compare the filters, you look at the path of range, stop range, this is still to come, the transition. The phase linearity, which is nowadays is crucial, and especially for phased arrays, the name it already says, for phased arrays it is essential that you work with filters that have a linear phase. That's why we only apply finite impulse response filters with linear phase. The filter order, of course, so the box hermetic, the throughput delay. Are closely related stability. The effect of feedback, this all deals with feedback, because with feedback you can have an accumulation of errors. Just as I illustrated by when these pole zero are not exactly matched, that you get an accumulation error and suddenly this pole pops up again and spoils your whole system. And the sensitivity to coefficient variations. That's why this strange family of ladder and lattice filters are there. The sensitivity to coefficient variations is much lower than in the filters I have there. These are the quality parameters to look at if you really want to have a good quality filter. Here's a list that does similar things. The main thing I already said, linear phase. Most of the time we use linear phase, and it means finite impulse response filter and an even or an odd impulse response. That's actually, in a nutshell, the story about all these elementary filters. I could also be ready in 5 minutes by talking about this. all these parameters. The relationships, I said, I go quickly. maybe I only show this table instead of to go all the computations again, because we've done this all in fact. That is, we have here the filter type and the added sequence. you put in series comp filter we saw, and in fact it was also the order one, just like here. We could also do it another way, we could do it parallel with interface, infinite impulse response filter order 1, and an infinite impulse response filter order 1 delayed, with a delay in it. That also gives me, of course, a finite impulse response filter, and we saw such an effect in the combination of these two comp filters, which yielded exactly one Dirac pulse in the impulse response, which implies it is an all-pass filter. then, what am I? Yeah, you can, okay, of higher order, you can split the higher order fair. You have to, okay, recompute the fitting coefficients, order n, split it into more simple filters. Same goes for this. And here, oh, here I have what I said about the all-pass filter. Split them into comp filters. This is how all these filters are related. Or you can, okay, I'll go through them because they do not give. It's all the same service again. Go through it all. Yeah, okay, this is this all pass filter again. This is an enormous schematic, but. Which, okay, I tried to put all the relationships, but I think it makes things more unclear than it clarifies. Okay, there's one step, one other comparison. We've done it. We've done the Z transform, the impulse response. I now want to say something about the frequency domain. The frequency response, how to transform, because most of the filters that you have are low-pass filters, how to explicitly transform them to band-pass or positions or high-pass filters or band-stop. It is quite easy, far more easy than in analog filters. Because you have to do lots of transforms and scaling of axes. You do not have to do this here. This is really the first slide. Yeah, this is really the first slide. This is a bandpass filter. What is a bandpass filter? This is impulse response of a bandpass filter. And how do I construct the impulse response? I just multiply the low pass filter, the response of the low pass filter, with the cosine of the carrier frequency. That's all. Finished. Now I have a bandpass filter. Just manipulating the coefficients. You can see it as follows. Here I multiply this and. This is multiplication. How does it. What happens in the discrete time Fourier transform. You transform this here, you get this sum of two Dirac functions, and then this becomes a convolution. You work this out, you get here two terms, one for the negative frequencies and one for the positive frequencies. It really is a bandpass filter with the same shape as the low pass filter. That's all. There is a picture, I think, only beware that you are dealing with periodic spectrum, so you are now working within a range of plus Nyquist frequency or minus Nyquist frequency. It is not aperiodic. So. The same goes for high pass filter, and high pass filter is, I think, a special case as a low pass filter for digital filters, because high pass means I put the center frequency at the Nyquist frequency. Just at the edge, and this cosine
this F0 that you saw in the previous slide, or this F carrier. This F carrier comes now Nyquist frequency, 1 over 2ts. So 1 over 2ts, so these 2ts, they vanish and so have cosine n times F carrier. And this alternates, this is plus or minus 1. So the impulse response of a high pass filter is a sequence plus one minus one. This is what I do here, and if you evaluate this, then n is an integer, so cosine pi times an integer is minus n to the power of n, and it's plus one minus one times this impulse response, the low pass filter. Now, you can check for the at the discrete time Fourier transform, and you get this output and these two parts, this positive frequencies, negative frequencies, positive frequencies, they are exactly located on the Nyquist frequency, and that is, because this one is negative, this one is minus Nyquist frequency, this one is positive on the plus Nyquist frequency. There is a part that is out of reach. And it doesn't matter, these are the same, so the periodicity is, the periodicity is preserved. I'm looking for a slide where this picturized, because a Ben Stott filter is equally by a trick. You take the impulse response minus the bandpass filter, like this, and from impulse response is not that clear, but from the frequency response you see one minus bandpass filter. Yeah, this is Ben Stott filter. Just the inverse of a bandpass filter, and in this way you can create a specific band where you want to stop all signals for the path. And these are the corresponding pictures. This is typically for a low pass filter. This response with the with monotonously decreasing, and here is the location of the frequency spectrum in one period. Now, a bandpass filter like this has responses like this, a harmonic which is sampled harmonic which is decreasing, and then within one period you have here two spectra. But the other period here, this repeats, this pattern. So the more you shift it to there, then the more this shift to there. And for high pass filter, they coincide. You have only one. And here you have also an oscillating signal. Now you see plus one, minus one, plus, minus, plus one. This, if you have such an alternating sequence, then this is characteristic for a high pass filter. And for a band stop filter, you have this one. I did also did it like this one, and one minus this one, and when you end up like this one, you start to block frequencies here. This is a generic method. Everything clear still? 3 o'clock. This is actually all about the analysis in the or the things to discuss in the frequency response, and I now come to synthesis. Shall we first have a break?
Maybe
a short break?
5 minutes, yes.
Yeah.
5-10 minutes
break. Yes,
okay.
Yes. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, but 10 minutes break and then we continue.
Yes.
And because, yeah, I have to see what I skip and what not. Okay, so let me think. That is,